Hi, I'm Whitney Espick, the CEO of the MIT Alumni Association, and I hope you enjoy this digital production created for alumni and friends like you.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the second virtual Brass Wrap Melt. For those of you who I have not yet met, I am Annalisa Weigel, and I have the privilege of serving as your president of the MIT Alumni Association. There are so many reasons that I love being part of the MIT community and why when I say IHTFP, for me, it means I have truly found paradise. One powerful reason is that feeling of being connected to MIT students, both today's and the nearly 143,000 individuals who once were, through the Only at MIT traditions that we share. And the Brass Rat Ring is certainly one of our most Only at MIT traditions. I am delighted that we have so many current students, alumni, MIT families, and friends joining us to celebrate this hard-earned and well-deserved symbol of the Institute. It is one that represents the connections of MIT alumni across generations, of shared experiences, values, friendship, and better world-making accomplishments. I'm delighted that the members of MIT's sophomore class, the class of 2024, now have the chance to participate in this meaningful bond. I'm looking forward to seeing the reveal of their class's unique design. For those of you who joined us last year, you'll note that this is the second year of holding the Brass Wrap Melt online and an example in which we have been able to lean into the pandemic era of virtual events to bring MIT people together as one, no matter where in the world you call home. This is also the third year of the Brass Wrap Melt project, a program in which the Alumni Association has invited alumni and friends like you to contribute to the historic meaning of the Brass Wrap Rings, as well as to philanthropically help bring down the cost for today's students by either gifting your own or your loved one's rings or by giving to the Brass Wrap Financial Assistance Fund. In that context, I want to offer a warm welcome to those of you joining us today who are members of MIT's Emma Rogers Society. The Society is a group of widows and widowers of MIT alumni, faculty, and staff who have chosen to keep the MIT community part of their families. Over the last few years, several of the Emma Rogers Society members have donated their late spouse's rings to the Brass Wrap Melt Project, and we are so appreciative to you for taking this action and extending your family's enduring legacy with MIT. We also have had a number of alumni who have contributed to the project, and I want to thank them too for thinking of today's students, also known as proto-alums. One such special supporter is Stephen Fantone from the class of 1974 in courses 6 and 15, and the founder and CEO of Opticus. In fact, Stephen is the alumni founder of the Brass Wrap Melt Project. Stephen is an avid collector of brass rats, and among his collection of some 30 or more rings from his fellow MIT alumni family members, his father, Joseph, class of 48, and son, Stephen, 05, and son, Dennis, 09. His mother, Jeanette, a surviving spouse of a member of the class of 1948, was also a founding member of the Emma Rogers Society, and she proudly wore her husband, Joseph's brass rat when they first dated. It was Stephen's family legacy and his love of the Brass Rat, as well as MIT, that helped Stephen work with the Sophomore Class Ring Committee, or RingCom, and the Alumni Association to launch this project. So thank you, Stephen, for all your hard work on this meaningful tradition. I know that we would all love to hear a few words from you.
Thank you, Annalisa. And thank you, my fellow MIT alumni, Emma Rogers Society members, MIT students, and most poignantly, the sophomore class of 2024 and their hardworking members of the 2024 Ring Committee. As Annalisa shared, the Brass Rat is not only special for me as a proud MIT alumnus, but it is also meaningful for the entire Fantone family. And it remains a profound honor to know that I've been able to help share the significance of the Brass Rat with today's extraordinary and talented MIT students through the Brass Wrap Melt Project. Launched in October 2020, the project, a partnership with the MIT Alumni Association and that year's Ring Committee, has become a beloved annual tradition for the MIT community. We thank the generous alumni and MIT family members who donated 10 rings this year to be melted and mixed into an alloy that will help create the class rings for the class of 2024. Their contributions also mean a reduction in the amount of gold material needed to create this next generation of rings. In addition, we thank all of you who have made philanthropic contributions to the Brass Rat Financial Assistance Fund over the years, ensuring that any MIT student who is experiencing a financial hardship can apply for help and get their richly deserved Brass Rat. I'm delighted to report that last year, alumni, students, parents, and friends like you donated nearly $20,000 to this effort, which translated into 100% of students who applied for support being able to receive their rings. Whether by donating the rats themselves or donating to help students obtain them, I want to applaud all of you for your continued commitment to the MIT community and to one another. And now on to the program. In a few moments, folks from the ring manufacturer Herff Jones will walk us through the melting process, and then we'll hear from our alumni and the 2024 Ring Committee, as well as MIT's Armed Coalition, before receiving a behind-the-scenes tour of the making of the new brass rats and the exciting reveal of the 2024 design. After that, there will be a live Q&A with students, alumni, and campus members involved in the project. Before we get to the main show, though, I want to pause and acknowledge that the process you are about to see is one in which the commitment to sustainability is key. Not only have alumni and friends helped conserve materials by recycling existing rings, but Herff Jones itself has received the highest grade given to large jewelers by Earthworks, a nonprofit organization dedicated to protecting communities and the environment from the adverse impacts of mineral and energy development. The company was honored as such for its efforts to implement Earthworks' Golden Rules, a set of criteria for more responsible mining that includes social, human rights, and environmental benchmarks. This means that our 2024 MIT students may wear their ring with extra pride, knowing that they are representing a commitment to healing our planet. And now let's look at the melt from Herff Jones.
Hello, I'm Jeff Quirk. I'm the account manager for the MIT Brass Rat Ring Program. I want to take a moment to thank the MIT alumni, MIT Alumni Office, the Class of 2024 Ring Committee, and most importantly, the donors for this MIT Ring Melt. And I'd love to introduce Betsy Sullivan.
I'm Betsy Sullivan with Herff Jones Operations. To the MIT Class of 2024 Ring Committee, thank you for allowing us to present the Legacy Ring Melt from our Warwick, Rhode Island facility. Our Herff Jones Warwick team considers it the highest honor to be a part of such a special tradition. Thank you to the anonymous donation from the class of 1976. Richard Adler, class of 1946. Hugh Barton, class of 1982, PhD, class of 1988. Gerald Broda, class of 1988. Rodney Brown, class of 1988. Jack Keston, class of 1958. Ronald Cotters, class of 1960. Masters, class of 1963, donated two rings. Richard Proper, class of 1943. Father Donald Rayla, class of 1971. Masters, class of 1972. Richard Smith, Masters, class 1975. An overview of the process of the Legacy Ring Melt. The Legacy rings are in this crucible. They will be poured into this casting furnace and heated to 1900 degrees Fahrenheit. Horrible. They will be poured into the smaller crucible and allowed to cool. Once it is cooled, it will be removed and will have an ingot of gold. That ingot will then be sent to refinery to remove all of the impurities and then return to us in grain form to be integrated into the class of 2024 Brass Rat ranks.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for being here with us tonight. My name is Ian, and I'm the chair of the 2024 Ring Committee. I'm joined by Claire, our vice chair, and Emma, our treasurer and study break chair. I would like to tell you all about the process behind the design of the ring that we will show you in a few minutes and a little about being on the committee. I'll start with a quick timeline. So traditionally, each committee is chosen during the spring of their freshman year. But because of COVID, our committee was not chosen until the summer, which put us on a much tighter timeline than previous committees. We met virtually over the summer, decided on a logo, and started setting up the foundations for our committee. As soon as we all arrived on campus in the fall at the end of August, we hit the ground running with art. The committee met twice a week for the entire fall semester, with meetings taking up on average 2 hours and 30 minutes, but many went to 3 hours late into the night on Tuesdays, when we all should have been P-setting instead. We quickly used up all 10,000 messages on our Slack channel, averaging around 80 a day, with many more texts being sent on the side. Communication was key within the committee. Throughout many events and meetings, the committee got to know each other very well and grew close. The meetings and the preparation for the meetings took a lot of time and effort, but I looked forward to it every day as we dreamed how the ring would come together. I can say without a doubt that this process was one of the most rewarding things I've done at MIT, and I learned a lot from it. By mid-November, we had finalized the design after hours and hours of iteration and discussion. It was very cool to see the final art and renderings all put together. It was a culmination of hundreds of hours of work. Now, at this point, our focus was on premiere and ordering, which happened just earlier this month. And I'll hand things off to Emma to talk more about those events.
Hi, everybody. I'm Emma, and I'm going to talk about the different events that Ring Committee puts on. So over the span of the school year, Ring Committee puts on 3 major events in order to build excitement and celebrate our rings together as a class. The first event is Study Break in October. This event is meant to build hype around the ring, get people to start thinking about the ring, and pull students for their ideas. MIT has an extremely high participation rate in their class ring tradition, and one of the keys to success is to get people thinking about the ring early and often. This year,
yes, our main three events that we've shown that we put on throughout the year is Study Break, Premiere, and then Delivery, which is coming up in April. So Study Break is an event hosted just on a weeknight during the year where we kind of pull the class about what they want to see on the ring. So we booked Lobdell in the stud. We had about 150 students from our class just swing by. They filled out a little form that had some voting on it that we pulled from previous ring designs. And we had them fill out some fields that were like, what are some new things that you'd like to see on the ring? And we were able to use this to kind of come up with ideas on how we wanted to represent our ring on our brass rat in a unique way. So after that, we had Premiere just earlier this month, where we got to show our class the design of the ring. So like I said earlier, the design is finished around mid-November, and then we get to show it off during Premiere. So we have to keep the design secret for about 2.5 months, which is very long, but once we were able to show it to everybody, it was really cool, and just being able to tell everybody about all the hours of work that we put into the project. And then, Emma, are you?
Yes, I'm back. Sorry, my computer restarted. So Ian just covered Study Break and Premiere. So our final event is ring delivery, where, as the name suggests, the students get to pick up their rings that they ordered. And historically, Ring Committee will pick a very large venue in Boston and put on an evening event for students to dress up in formal attire, wear their rings for the first time, dance, and take photos. And we are so excited to continue planning this event and look forward to making this one of the best ring deliveries to date. Next, I will pass things off to Claire, who will express our gratitude for donors.
Yeah, so as Emma said, we truly want to express our gratitude for this program and to all the donors who have donated their rats or donated funds to the Brass Rat Melt Project. So this is our third year of ring committees working with the Alumni Association, and this has been an absolutely fantastic partnership. The donated rings are physically becoming parts of the rings that the class of 2024 will wear. And the funds that have been donated to the program help ensure that every member of the class of 2024 can have their very own brass rat. Each year's brass rat is unique to the class. And so it was really important to the ring committee that we ensure that every member of the class could receive a brass rat. Like the year before us, we aimed to provide financial aid to purchase at least one ring to every member of our class who applied for it. And the funds donated to the Brass Rat Melt Project greatly help us in this goal. So now we'd like to walk you through our ring design.
So we will get started with the Hacker's Map. This is the Brass Rat's most well-hidden and most functional tradition. This year, we are inspired by years past to create the most accurate map of the main campus underground as possible. Built on data from every available floor plan and cross-referenced by numerous exhaustive expeditions, we can guarantee that every corridor, hallway, passage, or inlet present beneath the floors of MIT is here on this map to help you navigate from class to class, avoiding inclement weather, or to aid in completing any other activities you may wish to undertake out of sight of the general public. Also included on your map is a brand new compass rose to further hone your navigational prowess at MIT, the IHAT vector, akin to the unit vector notation, which we have all become familiar with, points due east, with three additional needles pointing in other cardinal directions. Following historical navigational tradition, this compass rose is adorned with decoration relevant to our journey. Encircling the four needles is a strand of RNA, representing advancements in COVID vaccines, which we hope will realign humanity's course back onto its normal path. Now we will move on to discuss the skylines. Up here first, you will see the Cambridge skyline. Upon graduation, the brass rat is turned so the Cambridge skyline faces us, featuring many MIT buildings and campus spaces that the class of 2024 called home during our undergrad years. The Harvard Bridge connects us back to campus across the Charles from whenever our individual paths may lead us. In the Charles, we see a crew boat and a swimming beaver, symbols playing homage to the many athletes in our class. The iconic MIT Great Dome and pillars sit at roughly the center of the skyline, similar to its central high-traffic location on campus. To the dome's right are Stata and the Green Building, two hallmarks of MIT's architecture and our campus skyline. Next to the Green Building, two hallmarks of MIT's architecture and our campus skyline are the transparent horizons, the sculpture next to East Campus, and the historically popular target for MIT's hacker culture. On the far right lies Site 4, the new tallest building in Cambridge. It towers over the rest of campus, representing the many new Kendall skyscrapers that have now joined MIT in the Cambridge skyline. On the other side of the Great Dome is the Student Center, a familiar site on Mass Ave and a place many members of our class have spent numerous hours in. To the left of the stud is Kresge, an icon of West Campus and home to many art performances. And last but not least, a simple Kresge, an icon of West Campus. And last but not least, a simple house stands on the far left of the skyline, representing many of our classes off-campus starts to MIT, either from our childhood homes or in a new home with newfound MIT family. The Cambridge skyline represents our fondest on-campus and off-campus memories and places that will always be with us as we finish our undergraduate years at MIT and beyond. Now, let's take a look at the Boston skyline. As undergrads at MIT, we will wear the brass rat with the Boston skyline facing us until graduation. The skyline represents the city of Boston and the plethora of opportunities that the rest of the world outside of MIT provides. The skyline is depicted at night, indicative of a view a student may see while up late, P-setting or studying for midterms, or setting off an unreasonable number of fire alarms. Additionally, one can spot Boston Commons gazebo sitting proudly between the reflective golden-plated State House and the uniquely shaped Hancock Building. Sitting in the river is one of our sailing team sailboats, representing the constant influence of the Charles on our lives, and also representing all the student athletes in the class of 2024. Directing your attention to the left corner of the skyline, we've included Faneuil Hall as a nod to Boston's rich cultural and political history. In the center of the skyline stands the Weston Copley Place Hotel, the venue where our 24-mal, our first class-wide event, was held. In the night sky hangs two stars depicting the two Boston marathons held this school year. The other buildings include a mix of ultra-modern and highly historical buildings to depict the dynamic nature of Boston's ever-evolving skyline. And we can also see a T sign signifying having fun in Boston. The Prudential Building is a staple of weekend trips into the city, and keeping up with the nearly 30-year-old tradition, we included the bright and eye-catching sicko sign. Towards the right, the Harvard Bridge represents Boston's accessibility and connection to Cambridge and MIT. Our MIT experience is largely defined by our late nights looking out into the Boston skyline, so its image on our ring can serve as inspiration for us all. Next, I will pass things off to Claire, who will discuss the class in Seal Shanks.
Starting off with the class shank. So the class shank is a constantly evolving presence on the brass rat. Although consistently set on Killian Court with a great dome towering in the background, the remaining details are unique to each class. The plaque on the dome is accurate to the great dome as it reads MCMXVI, which is the year 1916, the year in which the dome was constructed. Flanking the left side of the shank is a bare oak tree, which stands strong on Killian Court despite missing all of its leaves, symbolic of how our class stood strong through our first year at MIT without many of the exciting components that make MIT what it is. Standing opposite to the oak is a blooming cherry tree, similar to the ones that line the esplanade across the river. This tree signifies the growth of our class on an active and open MIT campus. On a column of the Great Dome, we see a barbershop pole pattern, which reflects MIT's hacking culture, as well as the Barber 70 scavenger hunt, that hack that took place on campus last fall. In the background stands Kerberos, the Hound of Hades, guarding the gates of hell. Serving as a namesake for MIT's curb system, our version also represents MIT's collaborative nature. Kerberos holds a gear and a paintbrush in two of its mouths, symbolic of our class's nature to create, whether it be through scientific or artistic means. Overall, the class tank is meant to represent many aspects that all of the class of 2024 shares. The class tank focuses on the technological capability, artistic skill, and creativity of our class. And now I'll present our seal shank as well. So the main feature of a seal shank is, of course, the classic MIT seal. We have reinvented this original seal by replacing the original figures with Athena and Hephaestus. Athena is the Greek goddess of wisdom and takes the position of a scholar representing the academic side of MIT. She is a symbol of the Institute, an embodiment of the thoughtful and practical nature of MIT students. She carries a laptop rather than the traditional book, both to symbolize our year of virtual learning and serve as a paragon of science and technology in the modern era. The back of the computer features an asterisk, a reference to CP Star, which was our first formal introduction to MIT. The other seal figure is represented by Hephaestus, the Greek god of blacksmithing, renowned for his hands-on innovation. He represents the thriving maker culture of MIT and our focus on applying our knowledge to the real-world applications. There are also four stars in the sky above the seal, representing the four flex PNRs that our class uniquely has. The horizon line embodies our hope for our class to reach new heights and be successful in all of our future endeavors. At the bottom of the seal shank, we also see a phoenix standing proud with its wings spread wide. The phoenix represents rebirth as we emerge from this pandemic, renewed and stronger than ever. The seal side of the ring is characterized by its adherence to tradition, and we have kept this intact while still personalizing it to our class to create a beautiful and unique 2024 seal shank. And now I'll pass it back to Emma to present our bezel.
It is a tradition for ring committee to design a fake bezel in order to confuse the whole class during ring premiere. Usually this bezel is comical in nature and picks up on many things that the students would not actually want to see immortalized in the ring forever. So here is our joke bezel. Everyone really did not want to see COVID in the ring, so we decided to fit it in as much as possible. We took this a bit further and made the dome itself into the virus particle on our joke bezel, representing how our entire MIT experience is shadowed by COVID. In fact, we tried to fit in COVID everywhere all over the joke bezel. Leaning to the left is a shape that many of us are familiar with, a COVID swab. And our beautiful Mass Tech dome is partnered by the buffest beaver you've ever seen in order to represent the fact that the MIT class is indescribably jacked. And floating on the Charles next to the macho beaver, we see a highly relatable fellow beaver drowning in pea sets. We just thought that the pea set pain really should be immortalized in the ring forever. And the PS5 building, the John Hancock building, is such a beautiful staple on Boston skyline, so we decided to feature it on the bezel as well. And speaking of Boston, we also wanted to shout out another Boston staple, the Boston Red Sox, who unfortunately took some L's this season. Next, I will pass things off to Ian to discuss the real bezel.
Thank you, Emma. So the class of 2024 has had an MIT experience that is anything but traditional, and we wanted our bezel to capture how unique our class has been within MIT's history. So this year, we gave the beaver the chance to put his swim certification to use. The past couple of years, the beaver has been on the Harvard Bridge, but we showed Tim overcoming the current of the Charles and pulling himself out of the river, ready to take on the world. Carved onto the log that Tim rests on is 157, representing us as the 157th graduating class of MIT. In the bottom left, we see a dock along the Charles Esplanade with a fire hose resting in the shape of an infinity sign. The fire hose references both the phrase, MIT is like drinking from a fire hose, and the infinite corridor we traverse through our daily commute to class. Floating in the river, we find a maple leaf representing our first fall semester on campus that we lost. An RNA strand can be found floating below the Great Dome, which is one of the key players in the development of the many vaccines which have made our return to school possible. Additionally, some of the ripples of the water form a heart, calling back to our first day on campus last year on a Valentine's Day. To the left of the bezel, we find the Harvard Bridge, standing upon supports that spell out IHTFP. Behind Harvard Bridge stands Kresge, Lobby 7, and the Student Center. Next to them proudly stands the Great Dome, adorned with our class year 2024 in Roman numerals. One of the pillars is replaced with an Apple Pencil, a tool which has similarly become a pillar of our virtual MIT experience. Next to the Great Dome and behind the Beaver sits Hayden Library, freshly renovated in our sophomore year. Behind Hayden, we find both Stata and the Green Building, the latter lit up to geographically represent the many MIT dorms. To the left of the Green Building, we find a crane, symbolizing the ever-expanding nature of MIT's campus and the innovation hub of Kendall Square. Now we cross over the river to reach the right side of the bezel, where you find the city of Boston. Standing tall are the John Hancock and Prudential buildings, towering above the Longfellow and Zakim Bridge. The Citgo Sign's iconic triangle has been transformed into a flexagon, which is one of the items that the class of 2024 received in our silver acceptance tubes. High in the sky, we find both the sun and the moon, representing the many different time zones we all lived in during fall of 2020. The constellation Auriga shines brightly above MIT's campus, embodying both the familiar cyclohexane and the myth of Eurycleonus, the mythological engineer who invented the chariot and was raised by Athena. We hope you enjoyed the design reveal for our class. Next, Herff Jones is going to share the making of a brass rat.
The MIT art process starts with meeting with the ring committee, usually twice a week, and we're providing multiple revisions for about 2.5 months. A very intensive process in working with the committee to achieve their goals of designing their brass rat. And then our team takes it back and works with the art team here to accomplish their goals of their particular brass rat design.
Once art is complete on the brass rat, it goes into CAD. And CAD is where they start laying in all the detail to prepare it for 3D printing. So MIT is a new ring every year, a new design with a lot of detail. It takes 2 or 3 people working on that to make sure we get all the layers with the detail and prepare it for the 3D printer, where we're able to put each individual student's ring wax through the 3D printing process. It's to their finger size, to that specific student's specification. So once the waxes come out of the 3D printer, they go into what we call the wax department, where they first are what we call tree up. So each ring, we use heat to make sure it can go on a tree. It then goes through a process to remove any of the support material that we need in the 3D printer, because the waxes are very brittle. From that point, we go into the investing department. So that's where they take them, and all the 18 karat gold is going to go into a single flask using a plaster Paris. The wax melts away, and then it is ready to go into our actual cast department, where the metal is poured into that flask, and then it goes through an overnight process through extreme heat in an oven. And the next morning they pull those out, and now we actually have a tree of metal rings. The interesting thing about an MIT brass rat ring is that every single ring is its own order, so it's a one for one. And so we have 2 people dedicated to actually handling those rings through the polish department. Because of the detail and the specifics on a brass rat, it does take an extended amount of time to make sure that we don't polish any of that detail out. It also gets antiqued for those who order antique, which is the dark finish on a ring. And so that is hand done. It's sprayed with what we call a lacquer, and it is hand wiped off again so we don't cover up any of the specific details that's very important to MIT.
On behalf of Herff Jones' team here in Warwick, Rhode Island, I want to thank you all very much, and much success to the class of 2024 Brass Rat Ring Program. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, everyone. My name is Victoria Gonan. I'm the Executive Director for MIT Alumni Association. And I want to thank all of our representatives on the panel tonight, Ian, Stephen, Jeff, and Jacqueline. So we have a few questions coming in from the audience, and I'll start with you, Steve. Do you have a favorite memory or story of acquiring any of these rings?
Well, let me tell you a story about how a brass rat facilitated a lifelong interaction with another MIT alum. It was March 31st, 1986. I'm in line at Logan Airport at 4 a.m. in the morning. My wife and I awaiting a charter flight to go scuba diving in the Caribbean. Most people in line are looking at their feet, wondering why they signed up for such an early flight. But ahead of me in line is an older gentleman, about 25 years older than I am, that I happened to notice was wearing a brass rat. And seeing someone with a little bit of energy, I moved towards him and asked him a question that only an MIT student can answer. And that was, what course were you? And of course, he looked at me and immediately we recognized that we were MIT alums because we each had brass rats. And he said, course two, and I told him I was course 6 and 15. And that started an interaction where we scuba dived together. We became friends that week. That friendship lasted a number of years, and he called me one day and asked me to join his board of directors. He had founded a company called Benthos that did work on the bottom of the ocean. I joined his board. I became chairman 2 years later, and together we sold the company 10 years later. That was a great outcome for him and his family, all facilitated by a serendipitous interaction where I spotted another person's brass rat, and it led to a conversation that would have never otherwise occurred. So I'm forever grateful for that interaction with a brass rat.
What a great story. Jacqueline, can you share what ARM Coalition is and what other kind of initiatives this group supports and how the funding for the rings is distributed?
Yes, of course. Hi, everyone. So the ARM Coalition was commissioned in the fall of 2017 in response to work that was being done by the Class Awareness Support and Equity and aims to connect students with campus resources when they're struggling with financial issues. The coalition is made up of over 20 members from staff all over MIT who meet regularly and work on projects that need research and advocacy conducted by one or more of our members of the coalition. You know us well, of course, from the Brass Rat Subsidy Program that we work very intensely on, but we also have ongoing projects around commencement housing and discounted tickets for commencement week events, summer student housing, and other major events around campus. So when it comes to funding for the rings, we have an open application that goes out to the students before the ordering process. And this is an application that goes out to the entire sophomore class. And it is each application is individually reviewed by each member of the ARM Coalition. And we determine who is eligible for a ring subsidy. And once we determine their eligibility, each student is given a certain amount of money directly into their checkout account when they're purchasing a ring, and they're able to use this funding to purchase any ring they would like from the list that Herff Jones gives them.
That's great. Question for Jeff. How many other schools does Herff Jones work with? And what makes working with MIT a unique experience?
Jeff, you're muted.
Herff Jones works with many schools across the country, high schools, colleges, universities, hundreds of colleges throughout the country. The MIT account is definitely a very unique account for us. And as shown throughout the videos, the biggest difference is the ring is completely redesigned each year. Many colleges and schools have traditional styles that really don't change year to year. So that unique element of redesigning and making it class specific is unique and exciting.
How many years have you been connected to MIT and this through the rings?
Yeah, this past class of 2024 is my ninth year that I'll be working with the MIT Brass Rat program. So it's an important part of my my daily activity is working with the MIT students on campus.
Sure, sure. You've been part of the journey. Question for Ian. What advice would you give to the next chair of the Ring Committee?
Yeah, I would definitely tell the next chair of the Ring Committee to use dot voting when filtering out ideas when first starting art deliberations. We spent a lot of time on art, as previously mentioned. Took a lot of time filtering out ideas, preparing for the meetings as well. I remember we would have all the notes from like our last meeting, and I'd sit there and I would consolidate all of them, or Claire would, and we'd put them on the agenda for next meeting. And that itself would take an hour or two, and then another hour in meetings as well. So dot voting would kind of help streamline this process. I learned about this after we finished the art deliberation. So it's when all of the participants in the committee would get a vote on options using a limited number of stickers. So for example, we would have a bunch of ideas written out on index cards, and we'd put them all out on a table, and you would have 10 stickers, and then you could put the stickers on the ideas that you liked. And then at the end of the short process, you're left with a distribution of what is wanted by most of the voters. This is a lot more efficient because when you have 12 students sitting around in a circle, only one person can talk at a time, and getting through hundreds of ideas, it takes a very long time in a roundtable discussion.
Good advice for the next chair. Jacqueline, how many students received financial aid from the MELT last year?
Jeff, you might be able to help me a little more with this one. Specifically from the MELT?
Yes, that's the question.
Yes. So I believe last year was a total of 250 students were awarded. But specifically from the MELT, I believe last year's gold was $5,500 donated to that financial aid program, specifically from the gold value.
Oh. And how many brass rats have been made?
Each class averages over 1,000 rings ordered. So we're averaging 90 to 95% of each class ordering, and they usually order about 75% order two rings, where they have an everyday non-gold ring, and then their gold ring becomes their dress ring.
Interesting. And how many? These are questions we're trying to trick you here, Jeff. How many pounds of gold are typically needed for one class worth of brass rats?
We offer various materials, so it wouldn't all just necessarily be gold, and that's a question I can't answer. Okay. I don't know the answer to it. I would share it if I knew it.
Right. Well, maybe, you know, find the answer for next year, right? Ian, how does the committee decide what to keep and what to change about the ring design?
Yeah, so a lot of it is just personal preference between people in the committee. We have a lot of really talented artists, and they have great artistic insight about things pertaining to the ring, symmetry, placement, density, and also just being mindful of what the class would want and how and what we want on our rat, because we are kind of, you know, the committee is made up of 12 students across campus from many communities, many living areas. So we kind of all come together and we bring our different experiences together to kind of make a collection of our experiences and put them all on the ring to really embody the entire class of 2024.
Mm-hmm. Really leveraging collaborative skills in the effort. Stephen, we should have opened with this question, but the questions come in. How did you come up with the idea for the Legacy Ring Melt program, and what motivated you to bring it to life?
Well, two things really did. The first was my father passed away in 1986, and it was clear that I would be the recipient of his class ring. But it caused me to think about, well, what ultimately does become of class rings when there isn't an obvious MIT graduate to pass it on to? And it wasn't until I was invited to visit West Point to give a technical talk, and we took a break and toured the West Point Museum. And in that museum, they had on display a collection of West Point rings and a description of their legacy program. And they talked about how meaningful it was to each year's class to have incorporated into their rings a bit of the legacy of a class that had graduated a generation before and carried forth that spirit and tradition of the gray line. I started thinking about that and said, gee, this really would make sense at MIT. The MIT undergrad experience is like no other. We all have a bond. We've been through boot camp, an intellectual boot camp together. And that bond that we share, I think, is part of that MIT brass rat legacy. And I noticed on eBay that I was an early eBay adopter, and I could see that rings were being sold on eBay for roughly the cost or the value of their gold. It was clear that they were going to be melted down. And I thought, at that point, the lesson is, and the message is lost. And I thought, what would I want to have happen to my rings and to be able to convey that legacy, that connection to the past with the next generation of MIT graduates could be very meaningful to people. And so I approached MIT about it, and I'm happy to say that the ring committee got it very quickly, and the Alumni Association got it very quickly, and the Advancement Organization got it very quickly. And I'm glad to see that how this has taken on a life of its own. And I think it is a great example of how MIT has a heart, and it really has feelings and hopes and dreams for the graduates. And we as alumni, as we see the class come through, really wish the best for them. And this is one of the ways that we convey that spirit to them.
That's great. We're so glad. We're so glad you made that trip to West Point, which helps inspire this. So last question, two parts for Jeff. We're still trying to stump Jeff. How long does the manufacturing process take to cast the brass rats? That's part one.
Sure. So the process of one-to-one manufacturing of the brass rats or any college ring averages 4 to 6 week start to finish process. But on a high speed, it's really about 7 day process of, step by step through the manufacturing of a class ring.
Okay, and the second part is, do most of the students order the gold ring or do they opt for other materials? I think you mentioned that earlier, but what does that look like?
Yeah, so it about 70% of the class does purchase a gold ring, and most of those students that purchase a gold ring, also purchase what we call a companion ring. And that tradition also comes from West Point. And that companion ring program is the cadets would have a non-gold combat ring that they would wear, and then they would have their gold ring for special occasions. And that tradition carried over at some time to MIT, where MIT engineers work with their hands. So they needed a daily ring, and then their gold ring becomes their dress special occasion ring. So that's still a very strong tradition at MIT as well.
Great. So that was our last question. So thank you for the participation in your Q&As tonight, the Q&A, and for being part of this novel digital event. Don't forget, you can support the project at the crowdfunding link that we'll be putting into the chat. And we'll see you next year at the Melt. And once again, Thank you to Stephen Fontaine, the Ring Committee, MIT students, alumni, the Emma Rogers Society members, Herff Jones, and Jacqueline Lieberman. So thank you all, and have a good evening.
Thanks for joining us. And for more information on how to connect with the MIT Alumni Association, please visit our website.